Psalm 20, a psalm of David. May the Lord answer you when you're in distress. May the name of God of Jacob protect you. May he send you help from the sanctuary and grant you support from Zion. May he remember all your sacrifice and accept your burnt offerings, Selah. May he give you the desire of your heart, and may all your plans succeed. We will shout for joy when you are victorious, and we will lift up our banner in the name of our God. May the Lord grant all your requests. Now I know that the Lord saves his anointed. He answers him from his holy heaven and with the saving power of his right hand. See, some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. Amen. We have a special, I was going to say a guest, but we have a few rows of guests with us today. And I am actually excited to have the Maulucci family and some of their extended family here. We have Pastor Nick's brother here and his sister from North Carolina, and we're excited to have them. I'm excited to have the Maulucci family. Now, they are missionaries to Bulgaria from America. I mean, I just want you to get this straight here. Pastor Nick and his wife Katie have been serving there for almost 2 decades. As they have hit the ground, the soil there, the hard soil, very hard. And they've been cultivating that ground for a number of years. Now, I don't know the family very well. I've got to hear about them for years from my wife and her mother and father. I've gotten to read a number of newsletters through the years. Now, the really kicker in all of this, Pastor Nick is not the superstar in all this. His wife is. If I'm not mistaken, you have 13 kids? 13 kids. And everyone that I've spoken to, have had any conversation, especially the boys, are sold out for Jesus. I mean, on fire. A couple of the older boys are attending. I believe 4 of them are going to be staying behind now. I'm sorry for the reminder, Mom and Dad, but as they will continue their education here in the States. But having some conversations with some of the young men, I mean, can I tell you something? They were so excited to tell me how when they were witnessing to some people, how they were rejected for the gospel that they were bringing, and how they took on some physical persecution. Because they believe wholeheartedly that we count it all a joy when we're persecuted for his name's sake. But they are sold out for Jesus. And I want to tell you, Mom, Dad, you have done a fantastic job. Again, I don't know them all, but the conversations I've had with a couple of your boys have been impressive. And I know for a fact that God is going to continue to use this family in the advancement of God's kingdom. And it's an honor for me, because I'm looking forward to hearing Pastor Nick's word, because it's always wonderful and always fresh to have a solid man of God deliver his word to us. Amen. So at this time, I'm going to ask Pastor Nick to come on up as he comes and shares with you.
Good morning. I'm going to set a timer so I don't go over my two-hour limit that I was given.
Feel free, bro.
So we've been in the States since June, but we're from Buffalo. My grandparents were both born in Buffalo, and we were brought up Catholic, obviously, as most people are here. My grandmother was full-blooded Polish. My grandfather was full-blooded Italian. And so we're from South Buffalo, so Lackawanna, West Seneca. But my dad visited a church in Rochester when he was about 30 years old. My mother's roommate from Erie Community College had gotten saved in Rochester, invited my parents to church out in Rochester, and my parents visited and heard the gospel for the first time in their life and got saved. And God just changed their lives at that point. And I'm going to skip a whole bunch. God touched my heart when I was 16 years old. I was brought up in church from the time I was 6. But God touched my heart when I was 16 years old to preach the gospel somewhere in this world. Just go somewhere as a missionary. And then through time, I went to Bible college in 1996. And in Bible college, God worked on my heart and led us to the country of Bulgaria. Of course, I was sitting in a little class there. It was probably about 10 students in the class called Countries Without Christ. And basically, we just went through the countries of the world talking about their political system, their economic system, their religions, stuff like that, some of their history. And we had been through many countries. It was a two-semester course. But as soon as that teacher, and he had never been to Bulgaria, he had visited like 50 countries. But he had just flown through Bulgaria and had spent one night. So he didn't have a lot of stories about Bulgaria. But as soon as that lesson started on that day in Bulgaria, I was 21 years old maybe. The Holy Ghost just squeezed my heart. As soon as he started speaking, and for that whole 45-minute lecture, I knew that God was calling us to Bulgaria. And we were engaged at that time. I wish I could tell you all the stories, but we met quite young. I was 17, she was 15. Yes.
Sorry. Sunday school, you guys can get out of here.
Let's go, Sunday school people.
All right. And then I get to hear about how you two met.
Okay. Come on, Sunday school. Nino, you going to Sunday school? You staying here? Well, I was going to introduce the family as they're walking out. I'll introduce the family right now. So, this is my wife, Katie. She's wearing green, raising her hand. And most people mistake her for my daughter. We had stopped in Watkins Glen. My dad pastors in Watkins Glen, or just outside of Watkins Glen. And I was in the DMV there. And Katie had gone in with Noah, who's sitting right here, right behind Pastor Whitman, and I was in the DMV. They walked across the street to get something from the gas station, to get a coffee from the gas station, and they took the order. The guy who was making the coffee said, "Okay, the order's ready. Who's this for?" And the person who took the order said, "It's for this young couple over here." They thought Noah was married to my wife, Katie. So yeah, I heard it when I got back, but. We were young when we met. My dad had pastored in Syracuse for 5 years, but when we moved to, my dad was an assistant pastor for a couple years in Palmyra, New York, which is at the northern end of Seneca Lake, southeast of Rochester. And we visited that church, and the auditorium maybe about twice as big, and I wasn't used to being in such a big place. And I was sitting over here. There was a preacher boy row where all the preacher boys sat. There were 6 or 7 of us. And we had been there maybe 2 weeks, and I looked over and saw what most 17-year-old boys see. I saw all the girls there. I said to the guy next to me, "I'm going to ask that girl to sit with me," and it was Katie. And so I did. She was 15. We sat together in church, and then we dated for 4 years, the next 4 years. We had our first official date on Friday the 13th of January, 1996, And then we were married on Friday the 13th of August, 1999. And so we dated for 4 years, and then we're married. And just an encouragement, you can live in the society that we live in, and you can do it following God's word. You can get to the marriage altar pure, because any sex outside of marriage is fornication. And it's nice to sing about how much we love Jesus, but it's better to live for Jesus and do his commandments. The Bible says, if ye love me, do my commandments. And so a testament to our parents, both of our parents. We made it to the marriage altar pure. That was our first kiss, and we've been kissing ever since, as you can see. So we have 3 boys in Bible college. Santino is a senior, Rocco is a junior, and Gianni is a sophomore. So they're not with us, and we sent them from Bulgaria, a very hard thing for us. And then Noah is our oldest with us. He will be leaving him in the States. We just got back looking at a college in Texas. But we'll be leaving him in the States when we fly back in a couple weeks. We fly back on February 14th to Bulgaria. And so Noah's number 4. And then number 5 is Vito. He's 16. Number 6 is Dom. He is 15. Born on December 13th. And then number 7 is Rafa, wearing his new suit he just got for the first time today. And and we had 7 boys in a row, and we thought that we can only produce boys, but then the Lord wanted to teach us patience and long-suffering and just mold us and break us, so he sent us 2 girls in a row. Where's our lovely daughters? Oh, good, they're not in here. I don't want to insult them. But God sent us 2 daughters back-to-back. Adela and Sophie are 12 and 10. And then I went back to the Lord. I was like, Lord, we learned all our lessons. He's like, okay, I'll send you boys again. So the 4 little guys are all boys. We have Sonny is 8. He's right here, Sonny. And Mikey must have went to Sunday school. He's 7. And then Nino. We had 11 children. We're like, we got this down. Like, we know what we're doing now. And then we had number 12 was born. Oh, my goodness. That boy has issues. That boy is a handful. But he must be in Sunday school. Nino is 4 years old. And then this is our baby, who's not a baby anymore, born on December 19th, 2020, Enzo. So he just turned 2. And so that's our family. We moved over. We moved over to Bulgaria. We traveled from about September, October 2001 to May or June of 2003, about 18 months or so. And then we moved over on July 29th of 2003 to Bulgaria. And we've been in the city of Varna for the last, it'll be 20 years this summer. And the Lord allowed us to establish a church there in 2005. We got into the country with a visa, with a foundation that we had started. We got our visas through the foundation. And for 10 years, we fed children at a handicapped school, and just school for handicapped children. And we just, our friends or churches that we knew sponsored these children, we just fed them a hot lunch. We did that for 10 years, and that's how we learned the language, just on the street. We never went to school. We all speak it. About 12 years old, they start speaking it. So we all speak it. We were tested by Lou and Nelly to make sure all our grammar was correct and everything. So, govorime jazika. I've preached about 3,000 times in Bulgarian and only 600 or 700 times in English. So if I revert to Bulgarian, we'll have to get a translator up here to do it the Bible way. There must be a translator. So, but we started the church in 2005. Since we've been there, we've baptized 60 people. 10 of them were probably our family, but 50 Bulgarians or so, and we've been in Varna, but when we go back this time, we're transitioning, and we'll be going to a more, we're looking at 3 or 4 cities right now in southern middle Bulgaria that are in Muslim areas. So there's the cities would be a mix of like 60-40 Muslim Orthodox or 70-30 Muslim Orthodox, but the surrounding villages are all Muslim. They're 100% Muslim villages, and every Muslim village has a mosque, No matter if there's 20 houses or 200 houses, they have a mosque. There's thousands of mosques. There's probably about 1,200 or to 1,500 villages around those cities. And so our goal is to start a church, which we will do right away in the city, but then work with evangelizing the Muslims. And what our experience has been that the Muslims will talk to us. They're just more open to conversation about God. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and they have a fear of the Lord, and most Bulgarians do not. Communism, it's not just Bulgaria, but communism, we hate communism. Communism rapes the soul of the people, rapes their souls. There's no other way to put it. We look at people every day. You're looking at a body. You're just looking into eyes that are dead. If they could kill themselves, they would. They have nothing to live for. These villages are, we've been in hundreds of villages where there's not one young family in the village, not one child, not one young couple. It's just people that have been ravaged by the government. Their stuff has been taken, and they're just trying to live out their lives there. So, but they need the gospel, because everybody needs the gospel. And the gospel is the hope, and Jesus is our hope. And so that's what God, he's called us to Bulgaria, but he's commanded all of us to bring the gospel to everybody. That's not a call. You don't have to be called for that. Well, I'm not called to talk about Jesus. Well, then what Bible are you reading? Because Jesus said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, Mark. So that's our job. That's all of our jobs as Christians. We happen to be in Bulgaria, but it doesn't matter if you're in North Tonawanda or Bulgaria or China or Africa. Our job is to get out the gospel of Jesus, because that's the only thing that matters. The only question that God the Father is going to ask us when we stand before him is, did you accept Jesus Christ, my son, as your personal Savior? For as many as received him, to them gave you power to become the sons of God. And so our job is to get the gospel to people, and that's what we do. I want to tell one quick, may I please tell one quick story about our ministry there? So the Lord has done many, I wish I could tell you all the miracles he's done where we live, miracles of just how he takes care of us financially. We don't have a contract with anybody. We don't have a paycheck. We don't have a denomination that we've gone with. We're just over there, and people send money, and that's how we survive. And God has taken care of us. We've had 10 children over there. It's more expensive to feed 13 children than it is 3 children. And God has taken care of every need over there, our vehicles, everything. But one of the ministries that has been a miracle and that God just opened the door for us was, we had started the church in Varna, which is about 500,000 people in Varna. And, you know, there's about 70,000 mailboxes in Varna. And we had hit those mailboxes maybe 5 or 6 times. Every mailbox with tracts, you know, Bible tracts or books of John or Romans. And we'd have a big day at church, and we'd go to every mailbox and give out invitations or do a meal at the church. And we did every single mailbox. We did that 5 or 6 times from 2005 to 2010. And in 2010, I was getting ready to write one of my letters to the people that take care of us financially here in the States, our friends and some churches. And on the top of our letter, the heading stated, the Maulucci family bringing the gospel to the millions in Bulgaria. Now, Bulgaria is not a big place. It's about the size of Ohio. There's about 7 million people. We just fell under 7 million people. So, but it's not a small place either. I mean, if you can imagine a state, you know, like the size of Ohio. And I read that heading, the Maulucci family bring the gospel to the millions in Bulgaria. And the Holy Ghost, he sort of struck at my heart. He said, but why are you saying that? Because that's not what you're doing. You're in one city, 500,000 people, but you're not getting the gospel to the millions of people in Bulgaria. It's just not right. So I kind of mulled that over for a couple weeks, and I came in on a Sunday night, and we might have had 30 people at church. I said, listen, we're not, no singing tonight, no announcements, people, we need to talk. Now, I'm going to fast forward a little. We've been in 185 cities in Bulgaria, on every street, at every house in those 185 cities with the gospel. We've been in over 2,600 villages, every street, every house in those villages. And I've been to 35 countries. I've been to Africa. I've been all over Europe. I've been in Asia. I've been in 35 countries. In almost every country, every other country I've been in, there you'll find churches. There's churches everywhere, different kinds of churches. You go to Romania, which is just north of us. You go to Romania, and you'll see the people. They'll walk down the road. They pass a church, and they'll cross themselves as they pass a church. A lot of Orthodox churches, a lot of Catholic churches. But they have they're very religious in Romania. Greece is just south of us. In Greece, it is a law that the Orthodox Church has to be the geographic center of every section of town in the entire country. I mean, we were just in Thessalonica. There's Orthodox churches everywhere. And Greece is very religious. That doesn't mean they're Bible believers. Don't mix religious with Bible believers. That those are two different things, because religion doesn't save anybody. Religion blinds people. Religion blinds people. The Word of God opens people's eyes. And you cannot rely on your religion to get you into heaven. It's Jesus Christ and the truth of the Bible. And so anyway, very religious country, Greece. But Bulgaria is not that way. And we've been in these 185 cities. I can count on one hand the number of churches that we came across where they're getting out the gospel. And so I came to our church on that Sunday night, back to the church service. I came to the church on Sunday night and I said, listen. I said, we have the truth. We know the gospel. We have the truth. Our eyes have been opened. And that's really what the Bible uses the term awakened. The worldly version, by the way, Satan always has a counterfeit for God's truth. The world's version is woke. That's the devil's version. Because you're either a male or a female. God made them male and female. And, you know, once we start leaving the Bible, all of a sudden we get real stupid. God gave us wisdom and truth in the Bible. And so I said to our people, I said, we have the truth. We got to get it to people. Who's out there? Who's knocked on your door? Who's given you a pamphlet? I asked our people, has anybody ever stopped by? I mean, you got some cults out there, Jehovah's Witnesses, you'll see them once in a while. And you'll see the Mormons once in a while, who believe that Jesus and Satan are brothers. They believe heresy. When John wrote Revelation, he put a period, and God said, you're not going to add anything to this, and you're not going to take anything away from this. And every religion, and Satan uses God's name to add to God's word. Starting all the way back with Constantine and the Catholic Church, the Pope could speak ex cathedra and he speaks for God. Nope, not according to the Bible. Nope, that's against the Bible. Muhammad supposedly heard angels and he wrote it down. This is after the last period of John, and now you have the Muslims. And then you have these whack jobs like Joseph Smith, who's from New York, who found these golden tablets that started the Mormon Church. You have all these people, they're adding to the Bible. No, this is enough. The Bible is enough. We got everything we need right here. So I said to our people, I said, we need to get the gospel to people. Let's just get the gospel to people. And so we made a decision that night. It was a good service, and we were fired up. And again, just a small church. I had some teenage guys at that time, and we're like, we're gonna get a John of Romans and a Bible tract into every house in our country, in the country of Bulgaria. Again, it's about 7 million people, so 2.5 million houses, something like that. So, man, after the service, I was fired up, got back in we had a Jeep Grand Cherokee for years over there. We had like 10 kids. I know it's supposed to be a 5-passenger vehicle, but we had 17 people in that thing. We'd take teenagers home. And I love America's boring. I love living on a mission field. You just do what you need to do. None of our kids have ever been in a car seat. That's why we bought the limo, because there's no car seat laws in a limo. Why would I strap my kid down in a car seat? So I'm like, we're on our way home, and I'm like holding on to the wheel with like that spiritual adrenaline, you know, after a good church service or after, you know, hear a good sermon, you're like, just, you're ready to like attack hell with a squirt gun, right? You're like, I'm going to do this. And we're on our way home, and it like dawns on me, like, how are we going to do this? We have 30 people in the church. You know, none of my boys were old enough for that. They were 9, 10 years old, the oldest at that time. And we had no money. We don't have like a working account with like $10,000 in it. We were living week to week. Up until 2016, we lived week to week. Like if my dad did not deposit the money that came in, we would not be eating the next week. We would print tracts and pay the rent. It was like, okay, we're going to print another 10,000 tracts to pass out. But we didn't have any working fund. There wasn't something we could nobody would call him. My wife and I had made a decision years ago that we would never let anybody know any of our financial needs. If God can't take care of us without us helping God, then that's not the kind of God I'm going to bring my family to the other side of the world and live on the other side of the world with. God can take care of everything, and he has, because you don't have to drop hints to people. God knows what you need, and he will take care of it. And so he has. Every step of the way, he's taking care of us. And so, but I'm thinking on the way home, I'm like, what on earth have we just decided to do? There is no way. How are we going to do this? This is impossible. We have no John or Romans. We barely have enough money to print our own tracts and just pay our own rent for our church building. And we have this whole country. We bought a map. We're looking at the map. I'm like, I don't know how this is going to work. A couple weeks went by. I get a phone call from the United States. I don't get many phone. That's the old-fashioned phone where you pick it up. There's like a cord that runs into the wall, you know. I get like 0.64 calls a year off that phone. I picked it up. The guy on the other end, he goes, Brother Maulucci, I don't know if you remember, but we met in Sofia 3 years ago in the Capitol in 2007. He said, we met, we were doing a project. I said, yes, sir, I remember. We had brought about 10 of our church members to Sofia, and they had a group of Americans that had just, they had bought Bibles and were just passing them out. Had a big meeting at Endeca in Sofia and at the big center, and they were passing out John and Romans on the streets for a couple weeks. I said, yes, sir, I remember. He said, when we ordered that container of John and Romans, we shipped it over to Sofia, we distributed it all on the streets. He said, but when we made the order in the States for those John and Romans, he said, the ministry that printed those John and Romans made a mistake. He said, they double printed that order. And he said, there's a container of John and Romans sitting in Ohio. It's been sitting there for the last 3 years in Bulgarian. He said, do you know anybody in Bulgaria that would want these John and Romans? I said, brother, you are not going to believe this one. I told him a story about like 3 weeks before on that Sunday night. He was weeping on the phone. He said, brother, our ministry, we still to ship it. That's $5,000. He said, we will ship the container. Our ministry will ship the container to you. And we're giving you a $5,000 check to print tracks, the first set of tracks. We received that first container in 2011. And we just started. We got a map of Bulgaria. It just started. And we have it. And we have my most prized possession outside of the Bible is that map. We have that map. We've marked all those cities, all those villages we've been to. We just started. Well, a couple years went by, and that guy called me again. He said, Brother Maulucci, how's the container going? I said, well, we're getting a little bit low on John of Romans. He said, okay, we'll send you another one. And they sent us a second container. They paid for it. We never paid a penny. A ministry printed it. They sent it, and we just had to pass it out to people. And then a couple years later, he called me again. He said, Brother Maulucci, how's that container going? I said, well, we're getting a little bit low again. He said, okay, we'll send you a third container. And they sent us a third container. And then a year and a half, 2 years went by. He called me again. He said, Brother, how's that container? I said, well, we're getting a little bit low again. He said, we'll send you another container. They sent us a fourth container. And then a year or so later, they sent us a fifth container. And then a year or so later, they sent us a sixth container. And then a year or so later, they sent us a seventh container. And when we go back in March, we'll be clearing our eighth container of John of Romans. We personally haven't paid a penny for it because God's problem with reaching the world is not finances. It's people that are willing to go and do it. God has all, he owns everything. It's not like God can't get the gospel out because we're not giving enough money. No, we can't get the gospel out because there's not enough people that say, okay, I'll go get the gospel out. Because he's taken he's shipped all the scriptures we needed. He's taken care of all the shipping. He's taken care of everything. And all we had to do was go to the doors and give them to people and say, here's the gospel, here's the gospel, here's the gospel, here's the gospel. And so since 2011, we've been to 2.1 million houses in Bulgaria with the gospel. And in the next 5 or 6 years, we'll finish the country. And we'll have gotten the gospel, just a little church of 30 people, to every house in the country of Bulgaria. To the Lord's glory. So if you come over to visit us, that's what we'll be doing. We'll be going house to house. And look, you can take your Bibles and turn to 2 Samuel chapter 16. I'll continue to talk. Or we're going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 16. The response when we moved there, you know, I went to Bible college at a very evangelistically minded place. We were out every weekend for hours, 6, 8, 10 hours every Saturday, and then all day on Sunday, just trying to get out the gospel. And in my head, I had my idea of what God was going to do, but God didn't do what I thought that God should do. And rarely does God do that. And there might be a hint in the Bible, because the Bible says his ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. And Brother Whitman sort of mentioned it, but there was like, you know, I've been in some rough places in America, Syracuse and Chicago and places where it's, you know, rough side of town trying to give out the gospel. But I've never been, I had never been physically assaulted until we went to Bulgaria. And I'm like, I got to tell this story too. I'm going to be here all day. No, I'm going to talk really fast. I learned Dobro utro, which is good morning in Bulgarian, right? And so I'm walking down the street. I have this merchant marine with me from Varna, and he speaks just enough English where I'm going to learn Bulgarian, because he doesn't speak very much English, but he speaks enough where we can, you know, communicate. So I learned Dobro utro. We're walking down the city street, and somebody walks by me, and I'm like, Dobro utro, to the person walking by me. And the guy I'm with, he stops, he looks at me, he's like, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm saying good morning to people. What, you have a problem with that? We keep on walking. Somebody else walks by. I'm like, Dobro utro. And the person looks at me, just keeps on walking, doesn't say anything to me. And he stops. The guy I'm with, he stops. He looks at me, goes, you can't do that. I said, what do you mean I can't do that? He said, you cannot just say good morning to people. They're going to punch you in the face. I said, you are crazy. I'm thinking, I have this American mindset that I'm going to change people one person at a time. You know, I'm going to give out a smile, and they're going to smile back. And I granted, Sofia is a little bit different than the rest of Bulgaria. We're not in Sofia. But he said, you're going to get beat up. And, well, we've been there 20 years now. When Americans come, I'm like, don't be saying good morning to people you don't know. Don't be talking to people you don't know. We've been punched in the face enough times to know. We had a guy come down with his son from Romania. His church came down to help us pass out John of Romans. And we had our church there. And his son was 20 years old, driving a van. Everybody got out. We're in the streets of Ruse, passing out books of John, and a Bulgarian came up to him. He's like, what are you doing here? He's like, we're passing out these John of Romans. He's like, get the blank out of here. Spoke a little bit of English. Get the blank out of here. He's like, well, no, we're not getting out of here. So I said to get out of here. Get out of this. We don't want this cult stuff in our city. He goes, well, I'm not getting out of here. And this guy just, boom, right in the face. That was his one-day visit in Bulgaria with these poor people. They've never come back to visit us since then. But look, people are the same all over the world. Men love darkness because their deeds are evil. That's also in the Bible. The seed that goes out has to fall on good ground. The seed is always effective. God's word is enough. But what kind of ground it falls on makes a difference whether that seed's going to grow or not. And so basically we're trying to plant and hoe the field and that kind of stuff over there. 2 Samuel chapter 16, let's look at a few verses here. I'm going to start reading in verse number 5. 2 Samuel chapter 16, verse 5. And when King David came to Bahurim, behold, thence came out a man of the family of the house of Saul, whose name was Shimei, the son of Gera. He came forth and cursed still as he came. So Shimei is going to be our character here. And he cast stones at David and at all the servants of King David, and all the people and all the mighty men were on his right hand and on his left. And thus said Shimei when he cursed, come out, thou bloody man, and thou man of Belial. The Lord hath returned upon thee all the blood of the house of Saul, in whose stead thou hast reigned. Look at that accusation. He's accusing David of stealing the kingdom from Saul and saying, you're reigning instead of Saul, and now God's getting you back. He's basically saying to David, God's getting you back. In the middle of verse 8, and the Lord hath delivered the kingdom into the hand of Absalom thy son, and behold, thou art taken in thy mischief because thou art a bloody man. So here we have Shimei, he's of the house of Benjamin. He's of the tribe of Benjamin. And I don't know, I'm only guessing, I'm inferring that the tribes of Israel acted a lot like we do even today a few thousand years later, and they were very tribal. That's why we call them tribes. And these Benjamites, the Shimei was a Benjamite, the Benjamites must have had some sort of pride in the fact that Saul was chosen from their tribe. I mean, first king, first human king of Israel, Saul, and he's a Benjamite of the house of Kish. You know the story. Samuel comes, he anoints him, and he doesn't even want to be king. But God anoints Saul, he's the first king, and the Benjamites were like, oh yeah, first king, he's a Benjamite. You know, he's from our, and this Shimei, it wasn't just the tribe either, it was like his family. It was like of his house, one of his cousins or something like that, of the house of Kish. And Shimei, in his head, we can't go through all the story, but you know how God took the kingdom from Saul and gave it to David. David, again, he did not ask for the kingdom, but Samuel went to Jesse, and he said, let me see your sons, and he went through all the sons, and finally got down to David, and he anointed David king of Israel because God rejected Saul after Saul had disobeyed him. Okay, so we know that story because we have the Bible. Shimei did not know that story. In Shimei's head, David had stolen the kingdom from Saul. In Shimei's head, he didn't know that Saul had tried to chase down David. You remember that story? When Saul is getting 3,000 guys together to go chase David down to kill him? Shimei didn't know the story of David standing in that pesherah, which is cave, standing at the cave, and there's Saul lying before him, sleeping, and David's officer says, he's right there. This is the guy trying to kill you. Just kill him and be done with it. God's given you the kingdom. He's anointed you. Just kill him and be done with it. Shimei didn't know that David said, I will not raise my hand against the Lord's anointed. Shimei was, he didn't have all the information that we have. And if you can kind of picture what's going on. Now, Absalom has rebelled against David, has tried to steal the kingdom from David. David's coming back. And Shimei hears the story, so Shimei comes out. And Shimei has this, like, righteous indignation. Like, he thinks he's, like, God is justifying everything. This is in Shimei's head. I don't think Shimei was a bad guy. This is just what is in his head, that David had stolen it. This is what he saw. David had stolen the kingdom, and now God, because God is just, God's going to get the kingdom back and going to take care of David because David stole the kingdom. So Shimei comes out. He's not afraid of anything. He's by himself. David's coming back with his entourage. And Shimei is out there by himself throwing stones. He's like, come out now, bloody man. Look what you did. God's getting you back. Right? I mean, it's all by himself. David, if David would have said, and we're not going to read the verses, but David's guards are like, David, let's go just take this guy's head off. Right? Who is this guy? He's like a dog. Let's just go take off his head. And if David would have said, off with his head, we would have read the story and been like, well, that guy deserved to have his head taken off. He was an idiot, right? But he felt that he was right. And so he's yelling at David. He's cursing David. And I want to look at David's reaction. I think we can learn something from David's reaction. Look at verse number 10. This is right after, well, verse number 9. Look at verse number 9. Then said Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, unto the king, unto David, why should this dead dog curse my lord the king? Let me go over, I pray thee, and take off his head. Verse 10. And the king said, what have I to do with you, ye sons of Zeruiah? So let him curse, because the Lord has said unto him, curse David. Who shall then say, wherefore hast thou done so? And David said to Abishai and to all his servants, behold, my son which came forth of my bowels seeketh my life. How much more now may this Benjamite do it? Let him alone. Look at those words. Let him alone and let him curse, for the Lord hath bidden him. David's reaction to Shimei cursing him was not a natural human reaction. And by the way, if we're going to be the light and the salt of this world, we cannot live with the natural human fleshly reactions that our flesh wants to give. People out there, well, I'm a Christian, and they live exactly like the world. They react exactly like the world. They talk about their goals are the same as unsaved people. Their morals are the same as unsaved people. Why would anybody in the world want that? David's reaction here is not fleshly. It is otherworldly. It is not normal. Because normally we're like, you curse me, I curse you. You cut me off, I cut you off. Well, maybe you're not like that, but I am. Somebody cuts me off, somebody does something to me, immediately my flesh wants to return evil for evil. David didn't do that here. I have to tell this story because I have my fellow Bulgarians in the room here. I love driving in Bulgaria. It is so much fun. It's just fun. I love it. Like, everything's a suggestion. There's no laws. You just park wherever you want, drive wherever you want. Except for Sofia. Sofia's got some order. But I'm driving. I had a Lada, 21 Lada Sedmica was my first car. This old Russian-made four-passenger. We had like five kids with this car, but we have this old car. Like, top speed is like 42 miles an hour, you know, going downhill. It's just, and I'm in town. I'm driving down the road, and there's like two lanes, but then there's like a bus lane. So only buses are supposed to be there. It says bus. It says no cars there. But again, everything's fluid over there. Nothing's really a law. And so here comes this Mercedes up the side. The mafia controls Bulgaria. They run Bulgaria. There's a Bulgarian saying that says every country has some mafia, but in Bulgaria, the mafia has a country. And they're run out of Varna, where we live. And so this Mercedes comes up. He's coming up the bus lane. He's going to pass me up. And so he's going to pass me up, but there's a car parked in the bus lane, also not supposed to be there, but if I slam on my brake, then he's going to be able to come in into the lane because that car is sitting in front of him. But I'm from New York. We don't use our brakes. What are you talking about? I'm not braking to let you in. So I just kept puttering along, and I could see him in my rearview mirror go around that car, and they're coming up the side, and I could see that they were not happy. Here they come again, trying to pass everybody on the right-hand side, and right before they're going to cut in again, another car stopped right in front of them. So I see them coming around. Now they're going to come around to my left side, and they were not happy. It's like two guys, like 50 years old. So I'm a fairly sociable person. So I rolled down my window because I didn't know if they wanted to, you know, greet me as they drove by or whatever. So they're driving by, and they pull up next to the car, and they're yelling and this stuff, you know, just mad. And I look over, and I probably shouldn't have said something like this, but I said something like, you drive like my sister or something like that. That did not make them happy. They had a bag of apples with them. And this guy in the passenger seat took this apple, and he proceeds to fling the apple at my Lada. And so I swerved, and he missed. And I looked back at him, and I'm like, and you throw like my sister too. Probably shouldn't have said that. These guys were mad. I mean, they were heated. He takes another apple, he flings it, and he hits the window right there, right here, and like half the apple flies off, other half of the apple flies into the car. And I had a teenager from the church with me. Vita, were you with me that day? This is a long time ago. I said to Yvonne, I said, hand me that apple. And we got to the next red light, I just returned their apple to them. But this is, look at, I'm just telling you, that's the natural human reaction. Right? I mean, it's just in us. Don't talk to me about my life. Somebody lies about you behind your back, you know what you want to do? You want to drop some information about them to other people here and there, right? It's just in it. David here somehow was able to control himself. Well, how is he able to do that? And this is, let me turn this sound off here. And this is what this passage teaches me. I think we can all learn from this. David did not know Shimei, or did not know him well. He even says, well, maybe God has told him to curse me. I don't know, but I'm not going to kill him. I'm just going to leave him alone. His reaction was a spiritual reaction. It wasn't a fleshly reaction. Because David knew something. He didn't know why Shimei was cursing him, but he knew that God knew. And that was good enough for David. He knew that God knew. It's not anything deep. David, listen to this one. We were just saying about it a little while ago. David trusted God. Hebrews says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. We sing about it, we read about it, we talk about it, but living it out is a harder thing to do. And that's what David did here. He didn't know why Shimei was cursing him, but he knew that God knew, and that was good enough for David. Every single person in this room has something in your life you don't know why. Somebody lied about you, something happened at work, something unfair. And now you may be in Shimei's spot where it's like you don't know all the facts, and so you think that you've gotten gypped. Okay, we're gonna have to wind this down here. You think you've been gypped, but we don't know all the facts. But whether it's on Shimei's side or on David's side, stuff happens in our lives that doesn't make sense to us. We don't know why it happens. We look at God sometimes and we're like, we want to say, or we do say, God, look at, I've been faithful in church for 47 years, been teaching Sunday school for 35 years. I've only wanted to live for you. Why is this happening in my life? These things happen. And David said, I don't know why, but I know that he knows why. And that's good enough for me. And he was able to control his flesh with his mind, or with his heart, with his spirit, because he had faith in God. He trusted God. You know, if my son Noah came to me and says, Dad, you know, you're leaving me here in America, and I'd really like to work at, you know, the Ford plant. And I'm like, son, you got a good job. Let's just say, you know, you work in construction, got a good job. I just don't think it's a wise idea for you to work at the Ford plant. I know some guys down there. I know this, that, or the other. I don't think it's a good idea. And he says, yes, sir, and walks away. And a week later, he comes back. He goes, Dad, I know we talked about it last week. I know you asked. I asked you last week if I could work at the Ford plant, but I want to ask you again. Excuse me. Do you mind if I work at the Ford plant? I'd like to work there. I said, son, you know, I just don't think it's a good idea. I just don't think you should work at the Ford plant. And he says, yes, sir, and walks away. And then the next week he comes back. He goes, Dad, I know we talked about it a couple times, but I really want to work at the Ford plant. I just really think it would be best for me. There's some things that I'd like to get done. I'd really like to work there. And I say, son, I just don't think it's a good idea. Do you realize that every time he comes to me to ask me to change my mind about him, he's not showing trust in me. He's showing distrust. And many of our prayers, look, it doesn't matter what we call it. How does God see it? Many of our prayers are to change something that we don't understand. But God knows why. And we're showing lack of trust in God. That's what David had. He just trusted God. Hey, look, if somebody's sick in a church, we should be praying for that person. Like, that's not what I'm saying right now. Let's pray for that. Somebody got cancer in the church, let's pray. Look, at our problem as Christians is not we're fasting too much, okay? I mean, I see, we're not fasting too much. But that's not our problem. We're not praying too much, fasting too much. I'm not saying not to pray. But when it comes to your own life, and you see something you want or you think you need or you think you could do better, if God would just work this out, just trust God. Just trust God. He knows. Look, I don't know why God put us in Bulgaria. We have access to go anywhere we want in the world. The churches that support us, they would. If I told them tomorrow, I'm going to the. If you've ever been to the Philippines, wow, those people love Americans, and there's churches everywhere. If we went to the Philippines, they'd be like, "Oh, more power to you." Is God moving you there? Yes, go to the Philippines. I don't know why God has us in Bulgaria. We don't feel like we've done, you know, got accomplished anything or done anything great or anything like that. And sometimes, like, we're beating our heads against the wall. But it doesn't matter if we see it. We just got to know that God knows. That's the only reason. May I tell one last story? In 2005, remember that old rule, women be silent in the church. Just kidding. Oh, I did that. Well, I said that one time at a. Wow. I was at a. No, I'm not. I don't have time to tell that story. But it was a deacon's wife at a picnic. Wow, that was not a good situation. But 2005, we were in Bulgaria. We just started the church. We were sort of beating our heads against the wall. And a Muslim man in Pennsylvania walked into a church that supported us, and they had like letters on the wall of the missionaries. He walked over to our prayer letter. He wrote down our email address, and he said, wrote me in Bulgaria. He said, would you please tell me about Christianity? Now, just that alone is like, what? I mean, the Turks, the Bulgarians don't like the Turks. The Serbians don't like the Turks. I know the Romanians can't stand the Turks. In fact, nobody likes the Turks. And we're in Bulgaria. We speak Bulgarian. That's not related to Turkish at all. But this Turkish guy, one time visited that church, wrote, and my wife's a witness of this. It's an unbelievable story. I wouldn't tell if I didn't have a witness because it's too unbelievable. I wouldn't believe it. If I was sitting there, I wouldn't believe it. He wrote me, said, can you tell me about Christianity? He called it Christianism. Can you tell me about Christianism? And I was like, okay. I hadn't dealt with Muslims at that point in my life. But the gospel's the same for everybody. The gospel's the same for everybody. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Jesus died for everybody, and the gospel needs to go to every person. And so I can give the gospel to right every person. But I hadn't dealt with Muslims. That same week in Bulgaria, I received a book from a pastor I never met, a church we'd never been to, a book called Winning Muslims to Christ. Same week. Don't tell me that's coincidence. Well, how can you stay in a place like that? Because I know there's a God, and I know he put us there. I've seen it over and over and over and over and over again. I could stand here for hours today and tell you specific details that are too unbelievable for chance. And I know God's there, and I know he has us there. Like, who sends a book, Winning Muslims to Christ, to somebody else they never met, and you receive it the same week that somebody, a Muslim, writes you and says, can you tell me about Christ, who's living in Pennsylvania, and you're living in Varna, Bulgaria? That doesn't happen. So I read that book, and I sort of used that book because I had no idea about Muslims. We corresponded for a couple months, and then on November 11th, my wife's birthday, 2005, that Muslim man wrote me, and he said, last night I trusted Christ as my Savior. He's in Pennsylvania. He said, can you go to Turkey and get me a Turkish Bible? And can you tell my friends and my family what you told me? Now, I don't know, but that's what I signed up for when I signed up for missions. I'm like, I want to see God do these. I didn't want to talk about other people's stories. Nothing wrong with doing that. I'm a reader. I read many books a year. I've read all the stories of Adoniram Judson and William Carey and C.T. Studd and these missionaries that went out and had amazing things happen. That's good. George Mueller. But we have the same God they had, brother. We have the same God. People, we have the same God. Just because I'm up here getting to speak today doesn't mean our God is the same God. It's the God of the Bible. We're the same flesh and blood that Elijah was, but that same God wants to use you to do unbelievable things for his honor and glory. And it is awesome. And I'm like, wow, I will meet you. I wrote the author of that book. I flew him down from Germany. He was in Germany at that time. Baptized over 1,000 Iranian Muslims in Germany, Nuremberg, Germany. Flew him down. We met. The Lord changed our worldview. I don't have time to tell you all those stories. But I've been to Turkey now 70 or 80 times, from 2005 to 2015. One time we got arrested, and we're standing up there, and the chief of police comes to me. Didn't speak any English. I speak a little Turkish. And he's like, I had two of my boys with me. He's like, are these your sons? Well, in Turkey, they love children, and they're like, you know, if you have male children, it's like you're extra blessed of the Lord if they're male. Well, at that time, we only had boys. We had seven sons, and I had a picture in my wallet of the seven boys. And I said, yes, you know, Evett, there are kids. I said, we have seven sons. And I showed him the picture of the seven boys. He looked at that picture. He looked at me. He asked the first question that everybody asks us. Are they all from one wife? This is the first question we get everywhere. Are they all from one wife? And thank you for saying that this morning. I say that almost everywhere. My wife is, I mean, to do what she has done, to leave her family and to leave the comforts of America and to birth children in a hospital over there and to be treated like garbage. They kill more babies than are live birthed in Bulgaria. There's more abortions than live births. Same thing with Moldova and several other Eastern European countries. We're expecting a baby. It's never congratulations. It's always, what? Don't you know you can have an abortion? That is the response we get. And anyway, this chief of police, you know, the inspector was up there trying to see if they had confiscated our materials and brought us to the police station. Chief of police took my wallet, and he walks behind me, walks into an office, and I can hear him talking, blah, 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 you know. And like 30 seconds later, like three heads poke out, and he's like pointing down. He's like, that guy has seven sons. He walked across the hall to the next office, tells him the same story. Four heads poke out. He points down. That guy. He walked to every office on that floor to tell them the story. They had captured an American with seven sons, you know. Like an hour and a half later, inspector was done. Chief of police came back with my wallet and a translator. He gave my wallet. He goes, number one, we apologize for putting you through all this hassle. Now, we've been arrested in Bulgaria before also. We've never gotten an apology. Have you been with us, Josh, when we've been arrested? Never get an apology. Number two, he said, we're returning all your material. Again, in Bulgaria, they have no right to take our material. But they've taken our stuff and not given it back. I'm not going to hire a lawyer and try to go all the way up. There's a court system. The Lord will provide. And then he says to me, he goes, number three, may I please have a book of John for myself? Now, look it. I don't know why God called me when I was 21 years old to Bulgaria. I don't know why God put us in that country. But if it was only to give a gospel to that chief of police of that Muslim city in Turkey and to live in Bulgaria for 30 years without fruit, it's worth it. Because I don't need to know why. I just need to know that God knows. That's what Christianity is. Trusting God. I'm going to read one verse. We'll be done. Go to Esther if you want to look at it. If not, I'm just going to read it. Esther chapter 2. Esther chapter 2. This is 550 years later. The Jews are in captivity. Haman wants to kill the Jews. Has already had Ahasuerus sign an edict to kill all the Jews. This is Esther chapter 2, verse 5. Now in Shushan the palace there was a certain Jew whose name was Mordecai, the son of Jair, the son of Shimei, the son of Kish, a Benjamite. It may just be that God sees things we don't see. David had no way of knowing that Shimei was going to have a son, who 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 was going to have Mordecai, who would be the human tool that God used to save the Jews from Haman. And like Mordecai said to Esther, he goes, if you don't go in and get the Jews saved, God's going to save the Jews, but it may be that you're here for such a time as this, if you remember that. I don't know. Look, we read and we know because we have the stories, but we don't know what God is doing in our life. Our job is to trust him that he knows. Trust him that he knows. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for its power. Its power to change lives. Its power and its principles, Father, to protect us from every wile of the devil, every temptation, to give us light on our path, to give us wisdom. Jesus, we thank you for your blood that you shed on the cross that washes away our sins. We thank you for your grace that reached into our lives through a preacher, through a tract, through a program on television, through a radio station, through a billboard, through a stranger, Father, where the grace of your gospel reached us. We thank you for loving us in spite of ourselves. And we only love you because you first loved us. And God, I pray that you'd give us the strength to trust you, to set aside our flesh and the things we would change, the things we would control if we could, and just to rest in your arms and in your hands and in your wisdom, and to know that you know best for us, that our lives may count for your honor and glory, God. We pray that you'd embed this deep in our hearts, and that we, like David, could be people after your own heart. And we pray this in the name of Jesus and for his sake. Amen.
Amen. It was worth you coming back just to deliver that message. Amen. Now, we understand today is Mission Sunday, and our offering plate is in the back. So if God has really plucked at the cords of your heart to do something extra, we would appreciate that. We want to send this family off with a meal. We have a meal there. There's a few more, so some of the older boys, you can't eat, all right? You have to fast. I feel God saying fast, brother. No, I'm only kidding you. You guys are going to eat. I'm going to ask if the family wouldn't mind, if you guys wouldn't mind standing, and I'm going to ask this body of believers to stand also. We'd like to pray over this family. Is that okay? Mom, you don't have to. You got a little one in your hands. We understand. Honey, why don't you come up? Father, we just pray for this family right now. God, it is not by accident. As you heard Pastor Nick say, Father, it doesn't matter what it is. God knows. God, you know why you have sent them. God, you have known why. Even hearing that story about having seven sons, Lord, you understand why that Father, you have blessed him with so many jewels, Father. And we see these young men going out, Father, into the mission field themselves. And Father, we have thanked you, and we thank you so much for how you've provided for them, and you continue to provide for them all of their needs. Everything that they need, you have equipped them for the mission field, Lord, and we're grateful. We're grateful for their sacrifice, Father. We're grateful, Lord, for one day they will be able to see, Father, the fruit of their labor, Father. As you've called each one of us in John 15, Father, you've made it very clear that we are your branches. And Father, we need to bear fruit. And we heard so much today. It's not just about accepting you as Lord and as Savior, but it's going out, as we read in Matthew 28, into that great commission and going out into all the world and preaching the gospel. So, Father, we pray a blessing into this family's life. We pray, Father, a hedge of protection. We pray, Father, that you would continue to advance your kingdom through this family. Now, Lord, we just give them into your hands, into your keeping. We thank you for the word that we have received today, Father. We thank you for the worship. We thank you for the offering, and not just the tithes, but also the missions offering, Lord. And we ask that you would bless it and that you would multiply it today. Now, Father, as we go into the fellowship hall, Lord, we ask that our fellowship would be sweet in your sight. That, Father, you would bless the food and strengthen it and nourish it onto our bodies. Thank you for each person that has gathered here, whether in this sanctuary or online. I just pray a blessing into their lives till you bring us back to your house again. I ask this in Christ's name, and everyone said, amen and amen. Thank you.